This is a great idea.
Thanks, Dad.
Do you think $35,000 will be enough to get you started?
Dad, I don't want a loan.
It's not a loan, son. It's a gift. I believe in you, son. I love you.
I love you, too.
I'll pay you back. I promise. I just need, like, $3,500 to get me through the next couple months. You know I'm good for it.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, everybody. Aren't you glad God has a plan for us financially?
Yes.
We're going to learn about that today. That was a little bit humorous. How many of us actually have to go to our parents for money? Sometimes we do. And how many of you know sometimes the parents have to come to the children for money? And you know what? It's okay. Because God has a plan. And he wants us to be there for each other. But today we're going to learn truth that's going to set us free and place us in the right position for finances in our life. Did you know there's a divine order and a divine plan that God has created for financial prosperity?
Yes.
Pastor Jerry touches on it every time she reminds us about how important it is to bring our tithes and our offerings to the Lord. So that there may be meat in my house, the Lord said. And prove me now, saith the Lord, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you have not room enough to receive. Today we're just going to learn a few things, not everything, but a few things that are going to really help us as we exercise our faith for finances for the family. Teresa?
Good morning, everyone. How many of you are excited to be at church this morning? Excited to be in the house of God.
Yes.
How many of you came this morning to get something from God?
Praise God.
You know, God has something special for you today, and it's you positioning yourself with faith in your heart to receive what God has for you this morning. You know, I've really been enjoying this family series. How many of you have been enjoying
Praise
the family
God.
Series? How many of you know we all have family matters that have to be dealt with? And it's just been a great series from the start to the finish. We're going to be wrapping it up today. But just as we wrap it up, I'm going to give you my one last tip. But before I do that, Pastor Stan's going to share about one of his books that he has really been enjoying. And this is an awesome book that he recommends for everyone.
Yes, I do. It's written by Ken and Trudy Blunt. Now, many of you may not know who that is, but Ken and Trudy Blunt are teaching, or how should I say this, are anointed ministers of the gospel who served for many years under and in the ministry of Willie George Ministries. Now, I know some of you may not be familiar with the person called Gospel Bill, but how many of you have been a part of Words of Life long enough to know the ministry of Willie George and the Gospel Bill Show? Look at those hands. All right, well, we're glad you're still here, praise God. Because this was way back in the 1980s and even into the 1990s. And how many of you know, even in a church life, we grow up, sometimes we move, sometimes we leave, you know, and there's new faces that come in. So you may not be familiar with this particular gentleman. But for years, he served in children's ministry and... Well, let me just read a little bit about this book just for a moment. Can you honestly say you are living today in God's perfect plan for your life? Is your marriage lacking something, but you just don't know what? Are you really connecting with your kids, or do you suspect that they're from another planet? Well, I'm just going to read this. Let well-known Christian authors and teachers, and that's their ministry, they have a teaching ministry, Ken and Trudy Blunt, guide you through the fundamental truths needed to prioritize your family relationships for profound achievement in the precious days in which we live. And so this is a book that I'm recommending if you want to enlarge your library, if you want to do more research about family life, if you want to study what God has to say, because this book is based on the Word of God and practical, real experience. It's called All in the Family. It's All in the Family, a fundamental guide to creating, building, and maintaining a strong family life. How many believe that's the will of God? It is.
Amen. All right, and we have the resource table out in the lobby, and we're still offering 30% off. And how many of you have taken your family photo? Have you taken your family photo yet in the lobby? Isn't that fun? Grab a family member. You might say, well, I don't have any family members in this church. We're all part of the family, so grab a family member, go get your photo, and then you know what? They're absolutely free. They're going to be on our Facebook page. You can download it. How many of you have done it so far? Have you taken your family photo?
I've taken one.
Oh, they put a few up there? That's a cool set there. So get your family, go out there, and take your picture today, because today is the last day of the photo booth. And then you know what we have coming up September 20th, just really quick, is our soul winning class. How many of you are passionate about the heartbeat of God? Are you passionate about winning souls and taking souls to heaven with you?
Yes.
Did you know that's the only thing that we can take with us? And that is why Jesus shed his blood, and that is why God sent his son. And you know what I've been thinking about? We need to be more sensitive in our heart for the leadings of the Holy Spirit on winning souls, because there are people in your path every day that need to hear the good news of the gospel. And did you know God has these Holy Ghost setups, that he has those people in your path for a divine purpose? But sometimes we get so busy in life doing our own thing and with our own stuff that we forget, hey, you know, maybe I could stop and tell somebody about Jesus. Aren't you glad somebody told you about Jesus?
Yeah.
Amen. So September 20th, Saturday morning from 10 to 12:30, come learn, because I'm wanting to learn more. I want to be more effective in soul winning. So come join us Saturday morning from 10 to 12:30. It's going to be with Dr. Dan, Pastor Barry, my husband and I, and we're going to have a great time. Everybody should be here, because how many of you know all of us can learn some more about soul winning?
Amen.
And just getting more fired up about it, because that's what Words of Life is all about, is soul winning, because you know why? That's what God's all about. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, we also have our new series coming up. It's called, it's about the Holy Spirit. Starting next week, we're doing a series on the Holy Spirit, which is right in line with what Pastor Jerry is speaking on Friday night. It says here, your best friend, he is here to help you go where you need to go, know what you need to know, and do what you need to do. The Holy Spirit, your best friend. Amen?
Amen.
So grab these invite cards. The greeters have them as you go out, and just take a few with you and invite somebody to come with you, because this is going to be an awesome series coming up starting next week. You know, and I'm equally excited about the Vision 101 class that Pastor Jerry was mentioning, because, you know, I'm going to be out of town on Thursday. I wish I could be here, but it was amazing last month, and it's only 1 hour from 7 to 8, if you can possibly make it. And, man, you're invited, too. It's not just for women. We want all of you to come. We had an amazing time last week. But the thing is, the consistency coming every month. It's just one Thursday a month. How many of you can make it to that?
Raise
your hand if you're going to be able to try to make that. It's going to be awesome. Okay, so I think that's it, except one last thing is my last tip on family matters. And then I'm going to go sit down. But my last tip is this. The Bible says in Matthew, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. That word treasure means deposit. So wherever you deposit yourself, deposit your time, deposit your resources, how many of you know your heart is going to follow that?
Yes.
You might be sitting there and thinking, you know, I just can't get into this family thing. I'm just not getting it, you know, with my family. I have to make myself do that. You know what? Just do it, because where your treasure is, wherever you put your deposit, your heart is going to follow that. So spend time with your spouse, spend time with your children, and as you do, you will see that your heart will get right in line and follow that. You know, I learned that from a very anointed man of God, Bob Harrison. He shared that. So it's not just about money. You know, you can deposit your money in your church, deposit your money in the things of God, and your heart will be there. But you can deposit your time, your resources, your life into your family, and your heart will follow that. That's my last Amen. Family tip. God bless you. Don't forget to take your family photo.
Thank you, honey. Thank you, Pastor Teresa. Appreciate that. Praise the Lord. Also, I want to thank my friend, Dr. Dan Galtieri and Dr. Eve Galtieri, because they're the ones who brought this book to me a couple years ago. And see, the thing is, the reason why this is so special to me and why I'm sharing this book is because I had a personal and do have a personal relationship with Ken, but it's, how do I say this? I haven't been in touch with him, though, for a very, very long time. But God, through the Galtieris, through this book, has reconnected me with him in my heart. Because you see, a lot of you don't know this, but for years I was the children's pastor here at Words of Life. And for years, you know, we used to have Willie George, known as Gospel Bill, to children around the world, come here. And Ken was a part of his team. And all I know is that this book will be a great big blessing to you. In fact, he put a personal little note in it, and I want to thank the Galtieris. I'm just sharing from my heart right now. And he said, to my long-lost friend, Stanmore Jr., rejoice! Hallelujah! So, I don't know if Ken will even see this broadcast, but if he does, Ken, thank you for the book. I appreciate it. Praise God. Well, today, God's going to do something amazing in your life today. Are you ready for him to do something amazing in you today? You know, he sent his word and he healed us. And delivered us from all our destructions. Did you know God has a plan for the family? And as we studied over the last few Sundays, we've actually looked at some of the different areas, marriage, children, etc. But today we're going to speak about finances. In fact, finances are more important than most people realize in the kingdom of God. In fact, what you do with your finances actually determines what happens to your life. And to your family's life. Last night, I was reminded by the Holy Spirit to study a book called Obedience in Finances by Kenneth E. Hagin. I recommend this book. And I just want to touch on it before we invite our special guest speaker this morning to minister to us along the lines of finances. We're going to work together. I'm going to say some things. He's going to say some things. And then I'm going to close out the service. But God's going to do something magnificent in all of our hearts today. But what I just want to touch on is this. Dr. Hagin wrote this, so I'm going to personalize it right now. Now, when he wrote this book, he had been in the ministry for almost 50 years. At the end of his life, Dr. Hagin had served in the ministry for 70 years. So I'm just going to paraphrase and make this real personal. And I want you to hear with your heart what the Spirit of God is about to say to you, because what you're going to hear can and will forever change your life financially, not only for you individually, but for your family. And for this church. Did you know we're also a family here at Words of Life? Now, last night, I went to the concordance and I looked up the word family. And to my amazement, I only found the word family one time in the New Testament. You'll find the word family in the Old Testament. You'll find the word families. But only one time, if my research is correct, and if I'm wrong, I'll correct myself next week. But if I saw it all correctly, only one time did I find the word family in the New Testament. I'm going to read it to you right now because we're going to pray over the family of God here. Remember, this series is called Family Matters. And if you and I will take these prayers to heart, and I'm going to just focus on just one right now. If you will take these prayers to heart, your family will change. Anybody need some changes in their family? Oh, we may all need some changes in our family, praise the Lord. And what I've learned is if you want your family to change, guess what? You have to change. A lot of times we want everybody around us to change. We want all of our family members to change. We want this to change. We want that to change. We want our finances to change. We want our financial position in life to change. But it all begins when we change. And the change that has to take place is not a change on the outside. It's a change on the inside. Because that's where God lives, and that's where God works in his people. He comes to live in us. Thank God he's with us. Did you know he was with us before he was in us? But when you accept him into your heart, he comes to live inside you. Now he goes where you go. And what he wants you to know is that if you want true change, real change, permanent change, may I use this word? Everlasting change, then that change has to take place from the inside out. So here's a prayer for the family of God to do what? To change us all from the inside out. It's in the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. Paul writes, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now listen to this. "Of whom the whole family." Amen. Woo, did you know there's a whole family? Yes. Do something right now. Call your family whole. Say, "I call my family whole." Hallelujah. That's a revelation right there. Listen to this. But listen, he's talking about the whole family now. "Of whom the whole family in heaven." Did you know there's a family in heaven? Yes. "And in earth." Did you know that there's a family in earth? Yes. "Is named. That he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man." Say, inner man. Amen. Say, that's where God wants to strengthen us. Today you're going to be strengthened. Today you're going to receive wisdom and revelation. So let me move on real quick. "That he would grant according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us." Everybody put your hands on your belly and say, "In us." Listen to this. "Now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him," here comes that word, Pastor Jerry, "be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end." Amen. Amen. Folks, what am I saying to you today as we conclude maybe this series called Family Matters? One of the prayers that you and I need to pray for the family of God and for our individual families, each one who's an individual believer and we as a family that are corporate believers, pray that your family be strengthened with might by his spirit in your inner man. Pray that each one be strengthened. You can pray Ephesians 1. You can pray Ephesians 3 for your family and watch what God does. Amen? Amen. Now let's go to finances real quick, because God's about to give us some wisdom and revelation. Kenneth Hagin said, from my experience of almost 50 years of preaching faith, he said, I concluded, listen to this now, that more people fail when it comes to faith for finances than anything else. Today's subject matter is faith for your family, for your finances. God's going to impart that to you as we hear the word. And here's the reason. Here's the reason why more people fail when it comes to faith for finances than anything else. That means that more people have faith for healing than they do for finances. This is what the prophet Kenneth E. Hagin wrote after decades of ministry experience. He said, I have concluded that more people fail when it comes to faith for finances than anything else. And then he tells us the reason. And I'm going to share the reason, and I'm going to turn it over to Brother Guy. Brother Guy Spirito is going to speak to us today. Brother Guy has been called by God into the vocation of finance. He is a professional certified public accountant. But before he's that, Guy is a born-again believer, filled with the Holy Ghost, a son of God who understands biblical finances. So we're going to call upon the wisdom and the knowledge and the understanding that he has. Not only does Guy work in the finance field professionally, but Guy is also an instructor at Life Christian University, and one of his courses is biblical finances. So he is very, very knowledgeable. And as he shares with us today, our lives are going to be changed by the knowledge of God. It's going to be both spiritual, it's going to be both practical. How many of you know there's a natural side of life as much as there's a spiritual side? How many of you know that you could have great vision today, but if you don't have the ambition to go with the vision, it's not going to work? There's a lot of people who talk vision, but not only do you have to talk vision, you got to work vision. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. So the reason, Brother Hagin said, the reason why more people fail when it comes to faith for finances than anything else is this, is because people, listen to this, people, Christians, or anyone else for that matter, we'll say it that way, the reason is because they're trying to exercise faith for finances, but they haven't planted any seed. People, listen to this now, and I'm talking generic right now, if I could say it that way. People want God to bless their finances, even though they haven't planted anything. And you want to hear something good about your Heavenly Father and how merciful he is to us? Even when we haven't done that, it's amazing how he has mercy on us and still helps us. Today, God wants you to know that he meets your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Brother Guy, come and share. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
You have all the time you want, buddy.
Praise the Lord. How's everybody? Hold on a second. I got papers everywhere in this Bible, so you're going to have to excuse me because this is my study Bible at home. So hold on one moment. Okay, you know, we're going to pray. So let's just bow our heads. Our precious Heavenly Father, we just love you so much, God. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for your holy written word that's forever settled in heaven. We worship you and magnify you, God. We thank you that you're the God of the universe. You're the King of kings. You're the Lord of lords. You're the everlasting Father. You're the Prince of peace. You're our joy. You're everything we will ever need, God. You said that with you we can do everything. Apart from you, we can do nothing. And God, we bless your holy name. I thank you that every word that I say, God, they're your words, oh God. And I lift you up, bless your name. I thank you, Lord, that our hearts are fertile ground to receive from you, oh God. In the precious, precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, Pastor, when we talked, we were talking about the importance of the family. So, and I'm going to try to move quickly here. So as a nation, the family is the backbone of any society. It's the backbone of any society. No matter what they tell you, the family is the backbone of any society. Every person, each and every one of us here, we have a desire to belong to something. That's the reason why you see gang members and things like that, because they don't have families. They want someplace they can belong. Our first focus, though, must be on God and then the family. Our first mission field must be our family. So many times we'll run out the door, and don't get me wrong, it's important that we witness to people, but our first mission field must be the family. Amen. If we get that right, you know what the Bible says? We're to bring up godly seed, godly offspring. I remember when Deb and I got married, that was our desire. You know, our marriage is important, but our children are important because they're going to be here for a certain period of time. And if you don't get it right, they will be with you for the rest of your life. But in your house. We want them in our house, but we want them to get married and go somewhere else and come back later. We love them. Working together as a family brings unity. Working together as a family, my father knew this, because when I was 6 years old, my mother made an apron for me for the restaurant. Six. There's no such thing as labor laws. Just get to work. And I'm gonna tell you, work is not a bad word. You know, we talk about work and we talk about prosperity, but let's go to Genesis 2:15. I want to show you this really quickly here. And I'm gonna move and make sure that I stay within the parameters here because it's really, really important. I thank pastors for just allowing me to stand up here. I remember when I first came to this church. You never think that you'd be standing up here, but it's just an honor, and I thank the pastors, and I thank God. But 2:15 said, Genesis 2:15, I'm reading it out of the NIV, so if it sounds a little different. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden. Now, this is before the fall, so remember that. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. See that? To work it and to take care of it. There's nothing wrong with work. You know, my father has an old saying in Italian that work stinks. Work's hard sometimes, but you gotta work. And even before the fall, it says that he put him in the garden to work it, to work it. So now I wanna talk about a couple of things. If you have children, this will apply to you, okay? Working together allows adults to offer on-the-job training to their children. Working together allows adults to offer on-the-job training to their children. It offers a way to instruct them, not only in financial areas, but in areas of life in general. You know, and this is the reason, because you're with them so much. When you're working together, you're with them so much, it will give you opportunities to dialogue with them about things that are unrelated. You know, sometimes when you're just sitting around, if you're working or you're doing things together, what ends up happening is you end up talking about different things. Like sometimes we'll be around the dinner table, and it's amazing what we'll talk about. We'll talk about everything. So many times it's so important that we spend time together. And look what happens when you're working with them. You will identify their strengths and weaknesses and can help them in these areas. This all can be helpful for their future plans. Some children are good with their hands. Others are good with numbers. Others are very outgoing. you know, sales, marketing, public relations, etc. And others are very good in school, and they may become doctors, dentists. But, you know, the one thing is this. Do not criticize one because they are not like you or is different or different from the other. So many times we'll say, you know, this one, oh, you know, you can do everything. You do everything this way. She does everything. She's perfect. But you know some, they all have abilities. Like, for example, I wanted to be a dentist. I had a 4.5 at Miramar High School, and I went to North Carolina State University, and my first semester, I had a 1.8. I was devastated. I had D's on there like you wouldn't believe. And so I called my dad, and I said, Dad, and some of you have heard this story. I said, Dad, you know, I'm thinking of coming home. And he says, yeah, you're coming home for Christmas. I said, no, well, I'm thinking of coming home. He goes, you're not coming home here. He goes, I'll break your head. You're not, that's exactly the words. And it always sounds worse in Italian because it was all in Italian. And so I said, well, let me talk to Mom. He says, no, you're not talking to Mom. I said, well, let me just say hello to Mom, please. Well, he ends up putting Mom on the phone. Of course, Mom is saying, it's okay, it's okay. And my dad's in the background and says, it's not okay, he's not coming home. Well, needless to say, I did go home, but I went back to North Carolina State. And I said, I'm going to do better this time, Pastor. And I did worse. I got a 1.4 for a total, grand average total of 1.6. Two problems here. You know, and I said, this has got to be the devil. It wasn't. You know, sometimes the Lord's trying to teach you something. Listen, I couldn't stand the sight of blood. What kind of doctor would I have been? I would have gone, ugh. Nurse, can you please take care of that? Pull that tooth out. You don't want me messing with your teeth. I'm going to tell you right now. But see, the thing was that once I prayed, I said, God, what is going on here? You know what he said? He said, you're in the wrong field. I went into accounting, business. And instead of getting 0 degrees, I got 3 from North Carolina State University. And see, the thing was, it wasn't how smart I was. And that was the other thing. The Holy Ghost showed me how these different classes would apply in different areas. So it's amazing how God will help you get before him. So having said that, I didn't become a dentist. I'm a CPA. So, but this is the other thing. Be patient as your children grow. I'm not talking about letting them do anything they want to do. I don't mean that. Because there are things you have to guide them on. You know, I didn't say that's okay when it wasn't okay. And you know, but the thing is that you don't always want to be on top of them. They have to make some decisions for themselves. And this is the other thing. I gleaned so much from my parents, from my father and my mother, just by being with them. It's amazing how much you will get when your children will get from you. You think they're not listening. They're listening. And they will become a lot like you. But you know, there's some difficult years. Weren't you difficult? Come on. I was difficult too sometimes. But you know something? I learned a lot from my mom and dad. This is the other thing. Don't try to do everything for them. Oh, you know, he'll fail if it doesn't. Well, let me tell you something. Here's something about, there will be times of failure. It is not your responsibility to always rescue them. A lot of times it will be financial failures like debt, traffic tickets, money shortages. It's a whole bunch of them. We helped sometimes, but very little, honestly, very little. Not because we didn't have the resources, but because they had to learn responsibility. They have to learn response. I know that young people back here are saying, is this guy, when is he going to be done? But it's true. Now look, and this is the other thing. If you help pay their bills all of the time, you will be paying their bills all of the time. Forever. So stop. This is true. I've seen this. This is true. Budgeting as a couple and as a family. If you have bad habits as a couple, it can carry into your children. There's a handout out there. I just wanted to let you know there's a handout you can pick up at the guest services. And all it is other financial considerations. I have my black and white copy here, but so it just there's a color one out there, but other financial considerations, just pick it up. It's just other things that you can look at, some other ideas. I just didn't want to go over them here today. But, you know, there's a couple of things in here. Let me just reference one of them. Get your monthly expenses under control. Spending on children. They don't need those $200 a pair sneakers. They don't. Put together a budget. Put together a budget. Some people have no idea. And I'll tell you, if you put your budget together and if you look at how much money you spend, you're going to say, oh my gosh. It was scary. When I figured it out, I said, oh, this is unbelievable. So I had to make more money. Here's another one. Stop frivolous spending and stop buying stuff you don't need. Frivolous spending on your children, like those expensive sneakers. They'll be just as good playing basketball in those cheaper sneakers. Then don't believe the Air Jordans are going to make, you know, forget it. Most Jewish families are very good with carrying good financial habits, and they do not baby their children in this area, and they teach them how to prosper. See, if you're constantly giving your children money, you're going to constantly give your children money, because it's human nature. It's a source. Say, mom and dad will just give me money, and then when you stop, they will not appreciate it anymore. They will say, you know, my parents cut me off. Well, yeah, they did. There were times, listen to this, this is another one. There were times when I had to stay quiet and listen to what the Holy Ghost was saying as it related to our children in certain areas. There were times when I couldn't say anything. I wanted to say something, but I knew that I had to be quiet because they had to work some things out on their own. Because after a while, you know, you want them to grow up, and you literally do want to cut the cords. Because it's hard to do sometimes, because you want to help them. You love them so much. You love them so much, and they make certain decisions. But you gotta let them do some things. Let's go to Acts 17. I'm moving here. Acts 17. Okay. Are you getting something today?
Yes.
Are you awake? Should I tell a joke? No, I can't. I don't have any jokes. Acts 17. Here, you know, I tell you, I love the Word of God. My Bible, I highlight the highlights. I mean, you know, there's so much in the Bible. Okay? Acts 17. Look at this one. It says, Acts 17, 24 to 28. I think I have it on the NIV, and you may want to reference it there. But from one man, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. And look what it says here. And he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should be. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him, look what it says, for in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. You see, let me just tell you something about the American dream. The American dream says you can do anything you want. But God says, I've predetermined your time and your place. But what we want to do is we want to blow that off. That's what I did. So I ended up with a 1.6 at North Carolina State University. But I was able to make the change. I can tell you times in my life where I haven't listened to the Holy Ghost. And sure enough, it's been failure. Failure. And you learn from these things. But let me tell you something. Take that scripture, and I've given this to the girls, Acts 17, 24 through 28. Read it and meditate on it and pray over that for your life. Don't waste your life. Look, life is short. 120 years is nothing. It says that, you know, we're like a blade of grass that's cut. We're here today. 120 years is nothing in eternity. Think about eternity is forever. Okay. But this scripture here says it all. We must first listen to the Holy Ghost. Okay, next thing. Many people have gone places and followed careers that were not the will of God. You know, let me just give you a perfect example. If many of you listen to Whitney Houston, this woman, when she would sing, was so anointed. She could sing the national anthem and it was anointed. She could sing anything and it was anointed. Why? Because she was called of God. And unfortunately, her life, I believe, was cut short because of the decisions that you make. And that's why I said, it's not how much money you make. It's are you listening to God? Because it's all about eternity. And we'll talk about that. And you know, people have wasted years of their lives because they missed Acts 17. They missed Acts 17, 24 through 28. That's where they've missed years of their life because they've not been listening. God has put you in a place. And the pastor didn't tell me to say this, but you know something? If you're called to this church, you need to stay here. Because I've seen people leave church because they're upset with something or another thing, and they've been called to a place. Okay, here it goes. As a family and as individuals in that family, we must hear the voice of God. You need to keep pushing that with your kids. They need to be hearing the voice of God. Now, there's going to come a time when they're going to make their own decisions. Here's another. Working together, like I talked to you, my parents, it wasn't whether or not we were going to work. It was what you're going to be here by 5 o'clock, and you're going to go to work. You know, have the kids help around the house. I know I've told this story several times, probably you guys know it. I have 5 acres, but the back two didn't have any grass. And the guy told me, he says, "Guy, in order to sod this, it's going to cost you about $30,000. I said, "No, it's not." 8 months before the house was done, I went to Home Depot and picked up 4 things of seed. And I have four girls. I divided the back 2 acres into 4 sections. I had a cedar. It wasn't the big commercial one. It was this cheap thing that worked. That's about it. I said, "Dawn, this is yours. Amy, you're next in line. Krista, this is yours. Amy, Betsy, here's yours." It was raining. They had mud up to their knees. But you know something? I got grass over there for $500. And it's still there. But you know what's funny about that? We as a family still talk about that. They're fun things because they weren't happy then. Okay. All right. And it doesn't, you know, even working together does not have to be structured employment. Just clean the house, cut the grass. Do things around, have them do things around the house. You know, my father taught me electrical work. He taught me plumbing. I didn't want to learn it at the time, but now I'm glad I learned it. He would say, "Come on, we got to go over here. We got to fix this. We got to, you know, at the time there was galvanized pipe, but everything changes, electrical." He taught us a lot of stuff because we were just with him. Okay. I'm moving. What time do I got? Okay. Now, if your children are older and you say to me, "Guy, but they're not 5 anymore." Start somewhere and reference back Acts 17 and pray that over them and show that to them. You got to give, you know, your kids, you have to show them the word and show them in your actions. One of the girls came up to me and said, "Guy, how do you remain so calm when things are so tumultuous sometimes with us?" I said, "Because I believe this, the word of God, more than all that other nonsense." And Deb and I, we would come together and we would go in our bedroom and pray. You know, and pray for our children. We love our children. I told the girls last week, we had everybody around. And I stood up at the table and I said, "This is the reason I get up to go to work every day, is to see our family around." Now I got a grandson, Donovan. We call him the Don. He's right there. He's so cute. But the thing is this, that's what we get up for. We get up because we love God, first of all. Number two, it's our family. Everybody wants to belong. Okay. Number two, if you've already got children and it's just you and your spouse, ask God to help you. Pray. People think they're alone. I can't imagine. I say, I don't know how people do it. There he is. I know this is real. I know this is real because you know why? This is my life. What I'm giving you here, this is my life. This is not something that I just said, well, you know, it's a nice, pastor's called me and just give a nice word. This is my life. And this is another thing. Work together as a couple. Work together as a couple. People don't work together as couples. They don't. Let's go to Luke 16. I want to show you this. This is a great scripture. Luke 16. When you listen to this, I remember I was praying. I remember telling Pastor Jerry, I said, Pastor, the Lord gave me this scripture that just really kind of changed things. Now this, I want you to keep in mind, this is Jesus talking. Jesus. All right. Luke 16, 1. Jesus told his disciples there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. Luke 16, 1. So he called him. Now this is Jesus talking. So he called him in and asked him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer. The manager said to himself, what shall I do? My master's taken away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do. So that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses. Look, this is what he said. I'm going to do this so people will welcome me into their houses. So he called in each one of the master's debtors. He asked the first, how much do you owe my master? 800 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, take your bill, sit down quickly and make it 400. Then he asked the second, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, take your bill, make it 800. Now this guy is talking on behalf of the manager. It's amazing, isn't it? He's saying, don't worry about it, just cut it. The master, look what the master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world, look what it says, for the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of the light. Jesus was trying to make an example here. Look what it says. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. But look what it says. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with very much. With much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will be dishonest with much. So if you have been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? And what he was saying here is that if he can't trust you, and this, you know, we can talk about this from a tithing standpoint, but I'm talking about overall. People are not good stewards of their money. They don't do what God tells them to do with their finances. I'm talking about as it relates to your family. Some people will take from their family so they can do something else that God doesn't want them doing. And so all I'm saying to you is this. Think about this. This is all about eternity. It's all about eternity. This is on-the-job training here. If you live to be 120 years old, don't miss what God has called you to do. And he said, if I can't trust you with these riches, how am I going to trust you with true riches? That's what he's trying to say here. So get on the wagon. Get moving forward in your life. Don't procrastinate. Here, we must be good stewards of what God has given us. I want you to go home and read that scripture again. Read that whole passage. Because you're not going to get everything out of it. But you're going to get things for yourself as you read it. We must be good stewards of what God has given us. Even Jesus was saying that the world was more shrewd than the people of the light. We need to be more shrewd. I know people that have no money, and we're Christians. You know why? Because we're not listening. We need to listen to what the Spirit of God is telling us. Here, my dad was 32 when he came here, and he didn't speak the language. 32. And he didn't speak the language. The man could run circles around me. He had a fourth grade education. Why? Because he was led of the Spirit of God. Amen. I'm telling you, the man was amazing. He could buy property in the middle of the desert. Next year, it's an oasis. It's amazing. Age does not matter. I don't care what age you're at. Get started. Get started. And when I say get started with your life and your relationship to Christ. The money will come. You know what the Lord showed me one time? He says, Guy, I'll put money in your hands if you'll just do what I tell you to do. Because I'll just put money in your hands. You'll work, you'll go out to work, and all of a sudden God will prosper you. Here's another one. Look, do not enable bad habits. Do not enable bad habits. If you've got bad habits, you got to change them. Do not enable bad habits. And let me tell you another thing. It's frustrating sometimes when you have one spouse that just doesn't have good spending habits. One's working, the other one's spending. It's really hard. It's hard on a marriage. So that's where you have to come together. And here's another one. If you plan, this is what, if you don't have kids. If you plan on having kids, what is the plan? What is the plan? Your children will need you, the ones that are born. You must plan now, not when the baby's born. Start saving now, working out a plan to nurture your children. Do not procrastinate. You can forget that curvy TV that they just came out with. It's expensive. I still have my TV from 2006 or something like that. It works fine. And here's the one, two of the last scriptures, and I'm done. Matthew 6:33. Are you staying with me? Okay. Here's the colorized version of that brochure, so just go outside to guest services. Matthew 6:33. I'll tell you, I love the Word of God. Man, I'll just sit there and I'll say, God, thank you so much. Matthew 6:33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is important. This is it. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be given to you as well. And you know, one of the areas when I had the financial seminar, you know what one of the areas that I got a lot of feedback was investing at a young age. If you're young, invest now. Find out what it takes now, because it's going to take a lot less now than when you're 60 years old. When you're 16, 17 years old, you can save a ton of money. And it's amazing, because I did it. If you started saving around $5,000 a year, when you're 65, you'll have $3.5 million based on the average. $3.5 million, you will have only put in $275,000. That's a lot of money. That's just a commercial. Last thing, Proverbs 13:11. Proverbs 13:11. I want you to get this one. Proverbs 13:11. Whoa. There we go. More stuff. Pastor's going to take me a little while to get out off of the dice here, because Proverbs 13:11. No, because I got all those papers, so maybe you'll have to help me. I'm just kidding. Proverbs 13:11. Okay, here we go. 13:11. What does it say? It says, dishonest money dwindles away. But this is the part I want you to get to. But that's important too. Don't think you can mess around. You'll have no money. You'll have no money. But look what it says. But he who gathers money little by little makes it grow. Sometimes we're looking for the big hit. And God's saying, just trust me little by little. And let me just say something to you. I'm closing now. Never give up. Never, ever give up in life. Don't ever, ever, ever give up. The Word of God works. It works. Don't ever, ever give up. It doesn't matter. Number two, never think that you're not good enough. So many times we feel like, you know, I want to tell you, my grandmother was the illegitimate child of an Italian count. That was like a governor in Italy. She was illegitimate. She came to the United States at the age of 17 years old, 1907. She gets adopted by a family that was involved with the mafia, to be honest with you. She ends up getting saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, changed our life forever, changed our family. I don't know anything about that. What am I trying to say to you? Wherever you're at, you're a Christian. Cut the cord and move forward, because you are good enough to make it. But what people will do is we forget that God is there with us. If you do this apart from God, it says with God you can do everything. Apart from him, you can do nothing. And if you don't believe this, you're going to struggle the rest of your life. I'm going to tell you, this stuff works. It worked for me. It's still working for me. And here's another one. Remember that your destination is eternity. You know, when you're going from Florida, from Miami to New York, you're on a destiny. You're going straight. You said, look, we got 2 days to get there. We're in a car, you may stop in a hotel, you may do all these different things, but I'm gonna tell you right now, your destination is New York. Your destination is eternity. And if you have eternity in mind and you're thinking about that, you'll do the right things all the time. Because let me tell you something, it's not, I was talking to one of the accountants in my office, and I said, you see this building that we're in? I own this building. You see it? But one day, it's all gonna be gone. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away. It's gonna make a new heaven and a new earth. So what you've got here means nothing. But God uses it as a vehicle here. That's what you're supposed to do. Use it as a vehicle here. You know, so many times we'll hold on to our dollars from our family, from our church, from different things where God's called us to do. But God's saying, I'll bless you. You know, he'll give you ideas on how to buy stuff. So just remember, your destination is eternity. And when you do that, you'll get it right every single time. God bless you.
Woo! Awesome word, guy. Yeah. Pastor Jerry, do you have anything that you would like to say along these lines? Okay. Praise the Lord. Folks, we're almost done. We asked if you can stay. Don't leave. Because God wants to minister to us. He wants you to know that it is his will for you to prosper and to be in health even as your soul prospers. So many times we're looking for prosperity. So many times we're looking for health. But did you know that your prosperity and your health is in direct proportion to the prosperity of your soul, your mind, your will, your emotion? That's why you and I have to be renewing our mind every day to the Word of God. That's why we have to take to heart the things that Guy has learned and the things that Guy has shared with us by the Spirit of God. I'd like to finish out just Guy's teaching just for a moment with verse 13. He was sharing from us from Luke chapter 16 about the rich man who had a steward. And God did a superb job. But when he said, turn there and look at it, I did. And then I realized, you know what? Let's read the next verse too. I'll start with verse 11. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, mammon in the King James means riches, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, that's why employees, you've got to be faithful to your employer. Amen. And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? But look at verse 13, because this was the end of the master's dissertation, if I could use that word, on this parable and truth. No servant can serve two masters. So my question to you today is, who are you serving? Are you serving God or are you serving money? That's what Jesus asked. And that's what Jesus was telling us when he said this, when he said, actually, it was a statement more than a question. He said, no servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Now, sometimes people read that and they say, oh, see, God doesn't want me rich. No, God wants you rich. That's not what God's saying at all. He's saying, don't let money be your master. Let God be your Lord and your master. And God will teach you how to handle money. Is that right, Guy? Amen. I have one last scripture before we go home this morning, because it is the will of God for everyone in this room to prosper, to be in health, even as your soul prospers. So I want your soul to prosper as I read these words to you from Psalm 115, beginning with verse 11. And if you have time, you can read the entire psalm on your own, 115, in your own personal time. But let's finish the service out this morning with these scriptures. I'm reading from the King James, Psalm 115, verse 11. He said, "Ye that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord." How many of you fear the Lord today? Trust in him. Trust in him today. For he is their help and their shield. He's your help and shield. Do you need help today? He's your helper. Do you need a shield today? He's your shield. Now here's what I wanted to say. This is what I'm getting to. The Lord hath been mindful of us. Say, the Lord's mindful of us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless them that fear the Lord. Both small. Oh, that sounds like our children. Both small and great. And then take this scripture to heart. The Lord, and I'm going to speak this over you. The Lord shall increase you, Words of Life Fellowship Church, you individually as a son or daughter of God, you as a husband or a wife or a mother or a father, grandfather, grandmother, whatever your position may be, he will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. The Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. Is family important to God? Yes, it is. It was so important that he said, Jesus, I'm sending you to the earth, and I want you to redeem man from the curse of the law. With heads bowed and eyes closed and no one looking, if you're here today and you would say, Pastor Stan, I've never made Jesus the Lord of my life, but I would like to. I would like to receive him. I'm here today, and I'm not sure if I'm on my way to heaven. I'm not sure about my eternal destiny as Guy described. I'm not sure. I'm not absolutely 100% sure that I would make it to heaven. But I want to know for sure. I want to know Jesus as my Lord. I want to know the person of the Holy Spirit. I want to know the master of my soul, the master who wants to be the master of my soul. So if you're here today and you would say, Pastor Stan, I've never made Jesus the Lord of my life. And or you would say, Pastor Stan, I know him. I knew him. I gave my heart to him, but I walked away from him, and I want to come back to him. Now that's going to take faith to make this decision, and God gives you the faith to do it. So I want you to, if you're here today and you would say, that's me, I need to make Jesus the Lord of my life, or I need to come back to him and rededicate my life to him. I've been like the prodigal son of old who was given his inheritance, but I went out and spent it in ways I shouldn't have, on the world's ways. And now I want to come home. I want to come home to my Father and be restored. If I'm speaking to you today about a new birth or restoration in your heart, in your relationship with your Heavenly Father, would you just raise your hand? Anyone in this room who needs to make Jesus the Lord of their life? I see that hand. We see that hand, sir. Thank you very much. We see that hand, ma'am. We see that hand. Thank you. Is there anyone else that would say, Pastor Stan, that's me. You're talking to me by the Spirit of God. Well, if I am, I'm going to ask those who have just raised their hands in faith because they do have faith. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I'm going to ask those who have raised their hand to come and join me at the altar right now. Please come. Bring your personal items with you. And if there's a loved one who came with you, who brought you to church this morning, I want you to come with them. If there's a loved one that you would like to walk with them, come. Because we want you to know that we're family. We are the family of God. And Jesus isn't interested in what church you go to. He's interested in what family you belong to. Ultimately, it is not what church we belong to, but what family are we in? And Jesus wants you in his family. Glory to God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Is there anyone else who would say, Pastor, that's me. I need to be up here. I need to come and rededicate my life to him. I need to come and give my heart back to him. I've been doing my own thing. I've been going my own way. And I'm making a turnaround. I'm repenting, Lord. I'm turning around and I'm going in the right direction. And also, if you're here today and you would say, Pastor Stan, I am a believer, but I've never been filled with the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. I've never been endued with that power from on high that will enable me, give me the ability to be what you've called me to be and to witness to you. You know, when I've studied the word and I've looked at Acts chapter 1, you know, so many times we think he gives us power to be a witness to the world. Well, he does. But the way I read it in the King James, and I know you can read it in different translations, but this is interesting to me. He said, that he pours out his power so that we may be a witness to him. Hallelujah. He wants us to be a witness first to him. And when we're a witness to him through our life and our decision to serve him, now we can be a witness to the world. But it takes the power of the Holy Ghost to do that. So if you're here today, you've never been filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, if you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, which is a gift from God, then come right now. Come. Anybody? I'm just going to wait just a little bit longer. If there's anybody that wants to respond to the infit, to be filled to this invitation for the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Okay. That means everybody here must be filled. That's a good thing. Now, for those who are here, I want you to know that the gift of the Holy Ghost is for you. Not only is the gift of eternal life available to all who believe on Jesus, but the gift of the Holy Ghost is also a gift for every believer. And as you believe on him, you are a candidate to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Y'all want to be filled with the Holy Ghost? Does this group in front of me want to be filled with the Holy Ghost? Amen. Amen. Church, I want you to raise your hands. We're going to pray for this group up here right now. You guys, we're just going to pray for you here. We're going to pray for you because we love you and because Father loves you, as you already know. But we're going to pray for you. I want the congregation to say, Father God, we thank you for each and every one who has responded to you, to your word, to your lordship through Jesus Christ and the person of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, do a great work in these hearts that are before you now. We pray that they receive every spiritual and natural gift that you have for them in this moment. We pray that they receive Jesus as Lord and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We surround them now with faith and love, and we say they shall all receive in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Now what we're going to do is we're going to send you with Pastor Marcus over here. for further prayer. You're going to pray the prayer of salvation. You're going to pray a prayer of rededication, perhaps. And you're also going to pray to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Just follow Pastor Marcus. And let's give them a great big hand, everybody, because this is what it's all about. Let's go right out those doors right there. Go right out those doors. Young lady, are you going to grab your stuff? Okay. Ushers, help her out, please. Make sure she gets there. David, if you could escort this young lady, please, to the prayer room. Praise God. Well, did you enjoy God today? Amen. More importantly, did you enjoy Jesus and God today? Hallelujah. Let's lift our hands to heaven and say, Father, thank you for your holy written word. Thank you that we have what we say. We say we are building strong families at Words of Life. We say you are building strong families at Words of Life. And we ask now that you have your perfect way in our hearts today and for the rest of our lives. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you, everyone. We love you. Be here next week because we're starting a new message on the Holy Spirit. God bless you.